The French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.
What's missing in this picture? The goose. And here it is, all juicy and brown and ready to eat. We're cooking a goose today on The French Chef. The French Chef. I'm Julia Child. Today we're cooking a goose, and here it is. Goose is a perfectly delicious animal, or bird, I should say. It's all dark meat, and it's juicy and full of flavor. And here it is, just sitting up, waving at you. Where its head is, that's the neck skin, and those are the wings. They're on a very large scale. And then right down here is the breast, and that's where all the heart, the lovely meat is, right in here and there. And there's your breastbone going down there. And one thing to notice about a breastbone is that this tip end of it right down here, you should be able to move it with your fingers like that. If you can't move it at all, it means the goose is old. And what you want is a young, roasting goose. And luckily in this country, all the geese that you get are young if you get it in a good market, and it says young, roasting goose on it. And the best size to get, I think, is not over 9 pounds. If it gets, you can do it 10 and 11, but it seems to me usually that the 9-pound goose isn't quite as fat, and it's usually much tenderer. And when you get the goose, it's usually frozen, and you defrost it the way you do any poultry. You either leave it in its bag, that sort of plyofilm bag, in the refrigerator, and it takes about 2 or 3 days for it to defrost. Or if you're in more of a hurry, you can do what many of the professionals do, which is put it in the sink with cold water, and then as soon as you can move the legs and the wings, and as soon as you can reach into the cavity and get out the giblets, do so, and then it will defrost in probably 4 or 5 hours. But it's fairly soon after it's defrosted, within a day at least, it should be cooked. And this one is about 9 pounds, and it serves 6 to 8 people. It's an enormous bird, but there isn't an enormous amount to eat in it. And so, although you don't have to stuff the goose, it's a good idea to stuff it if you want it to go a little farther. You can roast it without a stuffing by simply just putting in some cut-up carrots and onions and herbs and salt and trussing it up and then just roasting it. Or you can make a chestnut and sausage stuffing, or a breadcrumb stuffing, or do what we're going to do today, which is a really elegant one, which is going to be a prune and liver stuffing. We have these prunes here, that one will show you a little better, which has this lovely, flavorful liver paste in it. If you want to spend a great deal of money, you can get foie gras. That's that specially fattened goose with a great big liver. What we're going to use, now where did I put it? Oh, we're going to use the goose liver. And the goose liver is enormous. And this is only one half of it, and there's the other. This one seemed to come in 3 parts. But if you got a foie gras, the liver would be about, much longer than my hand, because that's a specially fattened one. The goose liver is usually a very pale pink. And a pale liver is usually the best color rather than the dark one, which one often thinks is the best. But the paler ones more approach the foie gras. So we're going to use this in the stuffing, so we just chop it up. And then we're going to sauté it in butter. I'm going to put in about a tablespoon there. And then in goes the liver. And we just want to sauté it a little bit until it just stiffens very slightly. And then also I'll put in a little bit of chopped scallion or shallot. And then the this should sauté for, oh, just about a minute or two. And then the prunes are tenderized prunes that are perfectly delicious. They're the kinds you get in a special sack, and you can just eat them the way they are. But for stuffing them, we have to pit them, so drop them in boiling water and let them sit for 2-3 minutes until they're soft enough to pit. Then you just take a little knife and take the pit out like that. And for a goose like this, let's see, this is a 9-pound goose, and it should take probably about 1.5 quarts of stuffing. That means an awful lot of prunes to pit. And stuff, you don't have to stuff them all, but it just depends on how much patience you have. And then we're going to do the rest of the stuffing. It's going to be liver paste. Now, depends on how much money you want to spend. If you want to get blanc foie gras, you can spend a tremendous amount of money. Or you can just get liver paste, which you'll find in your supermarket. Be sure that you get a good brand of it, though. And now when our liver is done, we put that into the in along with our liver paste. And then you notice there's that nice brown sauté juice that's left, which we want to add to our stuffing. And I'm going to deglaze that with a little bit of port wine. Or you can use a little bit of stock if you want, if you don't like wine. Then you let that boil down. And then we're going to put in a little parsley in here. I've got about 1/2 cup of liver paste and about 2 tablespoons of parsley, and then just a pinch of allspice. That's a very nice seasoning. And then if you like, you can put in a little bit of sage, which is also good. I'll put in about 1/4 teaspoon of sage there. And then when your liquid is all evaporated, practically, you pour that in. And then you stir it all up. And you probably want a little pepper in. And if you find if you've used liver paste, very often it will thin out a bit. So this is sort of really too thin to stuff. So use some dry white breadcrumbs and stir them in gradually until your stuffing has enough body so that you can easily stuff the prunes. Now I've put in about 1/4 cup because I was using liver paste. There. Then you stuff your prunes. Take a little teaspoon and just put it in the prunes like that. This makes a perfect, prunes and goose are just lovely together. Another good one is our apple slices and sausages. So when you get your prunes all ready, you are ready to stuff your goose. And we first have to truss the front end of it. And we've done an awful lot of trussing before, so I'll just go through this quickly. I'm using a knitting needle with a hole in it, but first I'm going to cut off these wings because they're... The wing, as you can see, this is the tip, and from there, there's very little meat on it, and you can use that in your stock pot, so just whack it off. I'm just whacking that off at the elbow, and then I save that for the stock pot. Then we want to truss these wing ends to the body, and I always do it in the French system by doing it with a big needle and thread. See, I went in under the wings there. I'll pull out that. And then, this is a wooden knitting needle I got at the 5 and 10, and it works very nicely. Then turn your goose over. And then you come in on the other side of the wing, and then up. I really came through backwards. I should have gone through the top and then the bottom, but you want to secure the neck string. Then you come down in under. This is mainly just to keep those wings in place so it'll look nice. And then just tie it I think this is much easier than those trussing needle things, and then cut it off. So you always truss the front first before you put your stuffing in, otherwise it would all fall out. And then put some salt in the cavity. I'm using about 2 good teaspoons in there. Then we put in our prunes. You don't want to overfill this, because the prunes will swell a little bit as they cook. And this has a lovely taste as it cooks. I don't think prunes are used enough in cooking. I like them very much. Now I've got about 2 inches of excess space there. I could probably have a little less. And then you take your tail and just fold it over there. And then we want to hold the trussing in by going under the leg and through the tail, and then under the other one. Sort of there. And then up through the skin at the top, and then pull it together. I had my string a little bit too long there. Tie it together. I haven't done this as neatly as I should have, but it's all right. And there, that goes, cut it off. And then we're going to prick the skin, because the goose has a lot of fat in it, much even more so than the duck. And so when it's roasting, you want to prick the skin with a pin or a needle, and you prick it right where most of the fat is, which is along the lower part of the breast, and then in through just above the wing, and then down here by the tail end and up through there. And then do the same thing on the other side. And then while the goose is roasting, the fat will ooze out of these pin pricks. There's always quite a bit of fat down in this part here. There, and then after you've gotten that all pricked and ready, you'll be sure to dry it off, because we're going to brown it first, and if you haven't dried it off, it won't brown. There's a little more neck skin than we need, and you can cut that off. Now another trick is, when you're trussing it, you can separate the, go in from the inside and cut between the ball joints where the wings attach themselves onto the chest right up here. And you can find that by wiggling the wing back and forth, and then you can cut right through that joint. Then another thing you can do is where your second joint, your leg, I can't even seem to find the leg anymore. Oh, there it is. There's your leg, and your second joint runs right up through here, and it attaches itself to the back there. And you can take a little knife like that and go right through the skin. This won't hurt the duck at all, the goose at all, and detach the ball joint from the back. You can tell when it's detached, because the second joint will move back and forth. And you'll find that it is wonderfully easy to carve when you do that, and people will think that you're a real whiz at it. And so now we're all ready to roast. And the first thing we're going to do is to brown it. So we're going to set it breast up in a roasting pan, and it's going to brown. It should brown in about a 450-degree oven. Because I want to do this quickly, I'm going to take the risk of browning it under the broiler, because I want you to see how it looks when it browns. I think I'm going to put this up a little higher. This is a rather risky thing to do. You have to keep your eye on it, but I want you to see several systems, because most everybody knows about the browning in the oven. And that, you start it breast up, and then you turn it over on its side, and then you turn it on its other side, and it'll take about 15 to 20 minutes to get a nice brown, crisp skin. So while that's browning, we're going to make our sauce. So I'm hacking up the wings, and then I have the giblets left. And this is one of these other treasures you find in your goose. There we had also the liver, and we have here the giblet, which has all been peeled. And then we have the heart, and we have the neck. The goose has a tremendously long neck. I'll whack that up too. And then we're going to brown it in oil, or if you've done with the rendering of the goose fat, you could brown it in that. You always brown things before you're going to make a sauce because it gives a much better color, and it also gives you a better flavor for your stock. And then we're going to put in, I've got two sliced carrots and two sliced onions there. And they also, when they get brown, give more flavor to your sauce and your color. If you do that, there isn't any need of using that sort of gravy coloring stuff. And when you're browning poultry, don't brown it in the oven because sometimes it burns and then tastes has an off flavor to it. And that the browning will take you 4 or 5 minutes. You want to be sure that you don't let your fat burn. I'm going to take a look at the goose now and see how it's doing. That's browning very nicely. I'll probably only have time just to brown the top of it, but if you did it like this, keep looking at it every 2 or 3 minutes and then turning it and just keep turning it. And you'll notice too when it comes out, even though it'll only been in a few minutes, that it will have already rendered quite a lot of goose fat. And now after your vegetables and your giblets have gotten brown, this is a very nice way of making a sauce and a stock together. You put on flour, and I want about 1.5 quarts of sauce because we want to serve 6 people, so I'm putting in 1/3 cup of flour. And then as always with making a French sauce, you turn the giblets and the vegetables in the flour to cook the flour a little bit. If you don't cook your flour, then you don't have a French tasting sauce. Then after that's cooked and it's taken on a light brown color, you then add your liquid. You take it off the heat, and I'm going to put in about 2 cups of red wine. You could use white wine or white vermouth. Or you don't need to use any wine at all. You could just use some meat stock. Then you want to stir that all up well so that you get your vegetables you get your flour and your liquid all blended together. And then that can be set over heat again. And I'm going to see now how our goose is. That's doing nicely. I think that I might turn it over. And what I think is the easiest way of turning is just to take some potholders or towel and just lift it over and turn it that way. And that will all, say, take about 20 minutes. And then this, if the stock should really simmer for about 2 hours to get all the full benefit out of your sauce. To get the full benefit out of your giblets. I'm just letting it cook here very slowly, and then it's going to cook with some stock. Well, I'm going to consider that, we'll pretend that our goose is as brown as it should be. So we don't take her out. And now, if you're going to roast your goose, you finish browning it. An oven is at 450. And you'll notice that there's lots of fat in there. And you keep taking the fat out, you can tilt the pan and suck it out with a ball baster. And then about every 10 minutes or so, baste it with a spoonful of boiling water, and that helps render out more fat. And this will, you keep turning the goose so that one third of its roasting time it's on the side and another third it's on its other side, and for about the last 15 minutes it's on its breast. And a 9-pound goose unstuffed only takes about 2 hours. But we've done roasting before, so this time I'm going to braise. And this is a covered roasting pan, aluminum, and it has a big cover that fits over like that. And it also has a rack which fits in the bottom of a pan, which isn't a bad idea because your goose can just sit on that and it won't stick. And then lift your goose into your pan, and it can go in breast up. And then when you braise, you always brown and then add a liquid. And then just add all of your sauce ingredients around the goose. And what's lovely about the braising method is that you not only have your sauce all made, but you render a lot more fat. And you have a lovely sauce or gravy at the same time as you're roasting your goose, so that you're really doing two things in one. And then after you have your sauce your braising liquid around the goose, you then bring it to the simmer again on top of the stove. And this is a particularly good roasting machine because it's nice and heavy. Then I'm going to put a little salt on it. And then it goes into the oven. It goes covered, and this would go into a 325 degree oven, and it would cook the same amount of time, 2 hours. And so now we're going to take out our goose from the oven, which you saw before, and get ready to complete our picture. See, this goose is beautifully browned and nice. And that took, so with the prune stuffing, that doesn't add a great deal more to your time because it's a light stuffing. Now there's our platter all ready. And we just take our goose out of the roaster. And again, I'm just going to lift it out, not with my bare hands, but practically. There it is. And then you just cut off the trussing strings. We have the trussing strings up at the front. And with the goose, you want to be very careful that you don't overcook it because the breast meat can dry out very quickly. That's one reason that you keep turning it while you're roasting it. And that's now all ready. And when it is done, it's always a good idea to let it sit out for about 15 or 20 minutes, and that allows the juices to go back into the flesh, and it makes for easier carving and juicier eating. And you can tell when the goose is done by if you can wiggle the legs, and they wiggle up and down nicely. And then if you take a little knife and you press into the leg, and a little pale, slightly rosy juice comes out. You don't want the goose to be overdone because if it is, the breast meat gets very stringy. But with this, that's just about right, and you can feel too by pressing it that it's tender. Because if you overcook it, it's just a terrible disappointment. And if you have, say, an 11-pound goose, this took a little over 2 hours. The 11-pound goose wouldn't take much more than about 2 hours and a half, because the larger the bird, the quicker proportionately it cooks. And then, for your sauce, you see, there's still fat on that. I had already degreased this to some extent while it was cooking. But degreasing is never a quick job. You take a great big spoon and you just go down into the pan like that, you see? And you pick up the fat that you can, And you just keep right on doing that. And then some people think, oh, it sounds so easy. It will degrease the sauce. It's usually a matter of four or five minutes. You just take off just as much of the fat as you can, and then pour the sauce through a strainer into a big pan like this, and then all of these giblets will remain behind. And then you'd set your pan over heat, and you'd bring it to the simmer, and then you'd let it reduce. You want the sauce to be fairly thick, just about like that. And then you taste it very carefully for seasoning. Be sure that you have enough salt and pepper and everything else in it. It's awfully good, I must say. And while it's simmering, you can still be taking the fat off. And then pour a little bit of sauce over your goose, which makes it look delicious and glistening. And then put the rest into a warm sauce boat. And to warm a sauce boat, just warm the sauce boat in hot water, and then put your sauce in. And so we have with us, we have on our platter some braised onions and some braised carrots. And if you want to, you can also add some more prunes. You could cut the prunes in some goose stock. And they'd be very pretty around it, too. And there we are. We have also some pureed chestnuts, and we have our sauce, and this would be eaten with a red Burgundy wine. I want to show you something about the carving of this. Now, I have done this business of cutting the ball joints, so these legs should come off very easily. You take the legs off first, and always you bend it back against its carcass. You see, that came off terribly easily because the goose joints are terribly tricky. They're sort of hidden in places, and they're much harder to cut. And now the cutting of the breast, I think, is the most important part of the goose, because your meat is all in there. And you take your knife and go straight down the length of the breast like that. Then there are several ways to cut it. I think one of the nicest ways is after you've cut down this way, then to come in slantwise. Then you get out little, that's what the French call aiguillette. First slice, like the first slice of cake, is always a little more difficult to get out than the others. And then the slices are like that. And that's lovely. That meat is juicy and just right. And so now you can cook your own goose. Bon appétit. That's all for today on The French Chef. This is Julia Child.
Julia Child is co-author of the book Mastering the Art of French Cooking. Furniture and accessories, courtesy of Design Research Incorporated. The French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.